This webinar, it will be, inshallah, a continuity for the role of a newborn screening in the kingdom of giving education for all the participants in this newborn screening. And today we are very thankful for Dr. Majd al-Fadl, who really accept our invitation in giving us and share his experience with us about hyperammonemia. And I'm sure being him with us, it's a very big add to the program. Dr. Majd al-Fadl, he is the head of genetic division and medical genomic research lab and deputy executive director at King Abdulaziz Medical City Ministry of National Guard Health Affairs, Saudi Arabia. Dr. Majd, we are really thank you for accepting our invitation, and inshallah, this is the first and will not be the last of you as being a speaker with us in the newborn screening, and the mic will be for you. And for the audience, please, any questions you have, just write it down, and we will ask Dr. Majd after his presentation 4 or 5 questions according to our time. And at the end of the webinar, we, inshallah, promise that we will ask all your questions to our speakers. Thank you, Dr. Majd, and the mic for you.
Thank you, Dr. Suhad, for this nice introduction. And I'm honored to be part of this fruitful webinar. Hyperammonemia is one of the vital subject in the era of a newborn screening program and the era of inborn error of metabolism. And it's very important to know this subject by all physicians working in a newborn screening program, including metabolic genetic physician and pediatrician and other specialties. So without delay, we'll start the presentation. So that excuse me. Yeah. So what is ammonia and how produced, how detoxified, and what is normal reference range? Ammonia is a compound of nitrogen and hydrogen with the formula of an H3. It's a colorless gas with characteristic bad odor. It's produced by transamination of amino acid and deamination of a glutamate. And there is two major pathways in our body responsible about detoxification of ammonia. One of them is a glutamine synthesis, and the defect in this pathway will lead to glutamine synthesis defect, which is very rare disorder.
Dr. Majd. Astazan, if you could share the screen, because now it's not shared.
Not shared?
Not shared. The slides cannot appear.
The icon doesn't appear for me. I don't know what it is.
You will find in Zoom, you will find the green button, share screen. In the Zoom.
Sorry for this inconvenient technical problem. We will be back soon, inshallah.
Okay, sorry for that technical error. Now you can see the slide.
No, doctor, you need to open the slides.
I open it already.
So when you click share screen, you will have some different options. You just click on the slides because now you share the screen itself. Can you open it? You can go now to the folder and I can see it if you just double.
افتح المحاضرة نفسها وخليها داون عندك على الشريط وبعدين شيرت من الشريط من تحت. يعني افتحها ومينيمايز ات وبعدين شيرت.
Now it's shared.
لا we are having your computer screen.
Okay, now. Open it again now. Did you see it?
لا يا دكتور ممكن بس تروح ممكن حضرتك تروح على الزوم.
أنا على الزوم الحين.
حضرتك تدوس على اللي هو الجرين بتن اللي هو شير سكرين. هيبقى فيه كذا اوبشن اختار منهم البرزنتيشن نفسها على طول.
I don't know what's happening. Now what you are seeing now?
ما فيش حاجة ما فيش شير سكرين حضرتك مش عامل شير سكرين.
أنا يطلع لي أنت بس. Now you hear, now it's fine?
Yeah, doctor, now it's fine.
Okay, sorry for this technical error.
No problem.
So again, it's detoxified by glutamine synthesis and urea cycle pathway. The normal reference range of ammonia is different from lab to lab and population to population. In general, in a neonate, it's up to 100 micromole per liter, while in infant, children, and adults reaching 50 micromole per liter normal reference range. So any level above these two figures, then we consider it as hyperammonemia. There is primary and secondary causes of hyperammonemia. Secondary causes, liver insufficiency, Ray syndrome, multi-organ failure, congestive heart failure, medication like valproic acid or haloperidol, systemic infection like herpes simplex infection or perinatal asphyxia, all causing hyperammonemia. The primary causes like urea cycle disorders, organic acid disorders, fatty acid oxidation defect, triple H syndrome, mitochondrial myopathies, pyruvate carboxylase deficiency, and so on. So how ammonia affects our brain? When ammonia enter our brain is rapidly converted into glutamine via glutamine synthase. And this is very important to know that the endogenous reflection of ammonia in our body is glutamine. So when you see in plasma amino acid high glutamine, then think about hyperammonemia. And once ammonia enter the brain, the glutamine accumulates in astrocyte, causing astrocyte swelling and dysfunction and causing cerebral edema and encephalopathy and we don't want to reach this stage. So very important that early diagnosis and early initiation of a treatment is important to increase survival and prevent irreversible neurological damage. So let's start with some cases to illustrate how to approach hyperammonemia. So 3 days old boy presented to ER with poor feeding, vomiting, and lethargy. Is a productive full-term normal spontaneous vaginal delivery, was well until third day of life. The antenatal history unremarkable, with normal growth parameter. Family history also unremarkable. On examination, the growth parameter were normal, but he is in deep coma. The CBC was benign, normal. Urea was less than 1. Creatinine 62, sodium 140, potassium 4, chloride 100, bicarb 18, blood gas showed pH 7.48, PCO2 20, and bicarb 28. So as you can see here, there is respiratory alkalosis. So what is the next step? Ammonia ordered, and it came 1,000 micromole per liter, which is very high according to the normal reference range. We order plasma amino acid and urine organic acid. Plasma amino acid profile showed decreased citrulline and arginine, while glutamine is increased. So as I said, glutamine is increased with hyperammonemia, but this patient has also decreased citrulline and arginine, while urine organic acid showed increased orotic acid excretion. And if you remember the urea cycle, you could see here that the urea cycle, and you could see here the citrulline. So the defect should be either in the proximal part of the cycle. And because the citrulline and arginine is low, and he is a boy, the diagnosis will be ornithine transcarbamylase deficiency. So what is urea cycle disorder? Urea cycle is a triad of hyperammonemia, encephalopathy, and alkalosis. And there is 6 enzyme deficiency causing urea cycle disorder. This is N-acetylglutamate synthase, carbamyl phosphate synthase, ornithine transcarbamylase, as we see in our case, arginosuccinic acid synthetase, arginosuccinic acid delays, and finally, arginase deficiency. All of them autosomal recessive inheritance, except OTC deficiency is X-linked dominant. The clinical feature, as we mentioned, is a triad of hyperammonemia, encephalopathy, and respiratory alkalosis, but there is many forms. What we present in our case is the classical neonatal form, the most baby normal at birth, and then at day 3 or day 5 of life or first week of life, they will come to you with poor feeding, vomiting, lethargy, and if you didn't treat them, they will progress to seizure and deep coma. The liver may enlarge, and serum level of transaminase are often elevated. In OTC deficiency, the classical form are more common in male. However, small number of female may have also similar presentation, and this is depend on X chromosome inactivation. The late onset form, it is less frequent, heterogeneous presentation. Some of the patients, they have recurrent or cyclic vomiting. Some of them, they have episodic hyperammonemia. Some of them, they have developmental delay, psychiatric sign like schizophrenia, mental retardation, hepatomegaly and elevated transaminase, and even asymptomatic patient was reported with urea cycle defect. To differentiate clinically between these different forms, there is some clinical hint. So for arginosuccinic synthetase deficiency, they will be microcephalic with a brittle hair. For ASL deficiency, there is hepatomegaly with a brittle hair, or we call it trichohexis nodosa. Heterozygous OTC, female with OTC, they will have postpartum hyperammonemia. So if you see any pregnant woman after delivery, she become encephalopathic due to hyperammonemia, think about ornithine transcarbamylase deficiency. Arginase deficiency is very interesting disease because this disease in the late part of the urea cycle and their clinical presentation is different from the other. Some this disorder, they have normal or mildly elevated ammonia, but usually they mimic cerebral palsy. Many of these patients misdiagnosed as cerebral palsy. So they present with spastic quadriplegia, psychomotor retardation, and seizure. So how to differentiate between different type of urea cycle disorder? The answer is simple. It's by plasma amino acid and orotic acid. So scenario just we presented, so that if you find high glutamine, alanine, and decreased citrulline, arginine, think about ornithine transcarbamylase deficiency. Very important to know the enzyme only expressed in the liver, so you cannot do enzyme assay in the blood for this disease. Similar to NAGS or N-acetylglutamate synthetase or carbamoyl phosphate synthetase. They have similar plasma amino acid profile of OTC, but usually they have normal urine orotic acid excretion, and we will differentiate between both of them by genetic testing. While arginosuccinic acid synthetase and arginosuccinic acid delays, the other name for these two disorder, citrullinemia and arginosuccinic aciduria, you could do them in fibroblasts. Arginosuccinic aciduria in RBC. Arginase deficiency also can be done in RBC. So this is the urea cycle pathway. Very important that all of us know this pathway because it's any effect in this pathway will cause hyperammonemia and urea cycle disorder. Again, the proximal part, we have CBS, NAGS, OTC. The later part of the cycle, we have ASS, ASL, arginase. And we differentiate between all of these disorders by the plasma amino acid profile and urine orotic acid excretion, except CBS and NAGS, we just differentiate between them by molecular genetic testing. So how to manage these patients? Always use this acronym, CHHNHD, which is circulation airway breathing for the C or basic life support, hydration, high caloric intake, nutritional management, hyperammonemia scavenger, and finally dialysis. Very important to know that the main management of hyperammonemia and urea cycle disorder depend on the first three, which is basic life support, hydration, high caloric intake, and nutritional management. So high caloric intake is very important concept to reverse the catabolism to anabolism. And it is crucial to take blood for plasma amino acid and urine for orotic acid before start the treatment, so as this is an essential step. If you take it after the treatment, the result may be affected. What do you mean by high caloric intake? We mean 110% higher than recommended daily allowance. So in critical cases, it's very important to calculate the calories while you are managing your patient and try to give your patient 10 to 20% higher than their recommended daily allowance, according to their age. And how to achieve that? Usually we achieve it by IV fluid, D10/15, intralipid, and if we can give orally, we can give glucose or porphyry and synthetic formula. What is the indication for dialysis in these cases? Ammonia does decrease less than 200 within 4 hours from start of therapy. So again, time is very important in these patients. Once they come to your ER, try to manage them as soon as possible because one minute mean difference. Any delay in the treatment will cause brain damage. So please, please, please take these patients seriously and try to start the treatment as soon as possible. If ammonia more than 360 initially, according to the new recommendation, you start dialysis. So what is mode of dialysis? Usually it's CVVH or hemodiafiltration is the method of choice. However, peritoneal dialysis could be done, but it is less effective. And the concept behind that hemodiafiltration is very good for toxic removal, while peritoneal dialysis is good for fluid overload. So yes, peritoneal dialysis could decrease the ammonia, but with longer time. This means the brain damage could happen. So please try to arrange with your nephrologist and your intensivist in the center to establish hemodiafiltration at your center and start these patients as soon as possible with dialysis if indicated. However, most of the patients, actually, from our experience, 95% of the cases that does not reach this stage, only 5%. If you start immediate treatment with high caloric intake, hyperammonemia scavengers, and nutritional management, you will not reach this stage. So what is hyperammonemia scavenger, their dosages and side effects? We have three scavenger, arginine hydrochloride, sodium benzoate, and sodium phenyl acetate. And ammunol is the synthetic solution of both sodium benzoate and sodium phenyl acetate together. The dosage is ranging between 200 to 600 milligram per kg diluted in T10 water and given over 90 minutes. The ammunol is given 250 milligram per kg for less than 20 kg, for more than 20 kg, 5.5 milligram per meter square. Potassium, very important to know, because this is a common question by ER nurses. Can we give potassium with the ammunol? The answer is yes. We can give the potassium in the same line of ammunol. Why we give potassium? Because this medication will cause hypokalemia. So it's better to give your patient 30 to 40 milliequivalent per liter from the start with you when you start your infusion. We don't prefer reloading. We reloading only in a neonate with severe disorder or those who are undergoing dialysis. So how this hyperammonemia scavenger work? The sodium benzoate will conjugate with the glycine to form hippuric acid. 1 mole of sodium benzoate will remove 1 mole of ammonia as a glycine, while phenyl acetate conjugate with the glutamine to form phenyl acetyl glutamine, and both compound, which is hippuric acid and phenyl acetyl glutamine, is easily secreted in the urine. 1 mole of ammonia will be removed as a glycine. The sodium phenyl butyrate usually used for chronic management, and it's broke drug rapidly compared to phenyl acetyl glutamine. This is how we administer the ammunol, as we mentioned previously, in different disorder. And ammunol must be diluted with dextrose 10% prior to administration, and it is stable for up to 24 hours at room temperature and lighting condition. You can mix it at the same container with arginine. You can give it at the same line with potassium, and you can give it a peripheral line. Yes, we don't prefer because causing burn, but in our Middle East hyperammonemia recommendation, we suggest that you can use ammunol through peripheral line and also from our spots. Case two, Mohammed, 7-month-old boy with arginosuccinate lyase deficiency, admitted to the ICU while you are luckily on call that night. And he was improving with hyperammonemia scavenger and high caloric intake. You are monitoring electrolytes. However, the nurse called you with glucose result of 20 millimole per liter. So what you will do? So in this case, please don't reduce the dextrose infusion and start insulin infusion, because once you decrease glucose, then you decrease caloric intake, and this will move the direction of your management to catabolism. So usually we start insulin infusion 50 units in 500 ml normal saline at quarter to half weight of your patient. The nutritional management usually included in this triangle. So it's a mixture of metabolic formula like Cyclinex, natural protein like Similac or breast milk, and calorie source like glucose or Profree. And your metabolic dietitian will calculate this and give the patient the required amount. Case 4, 3 days old newborn product of full term normal spontaneous vaginal delivery, birth weight 3 kg, found to have poor feeding, lethargy, ammonia 250, blood gas based 7.2. So what is the most likely diagnosis? And this scenario is propionic acidemia, or methyl malonic acidemia. I will not tackle in detail about this disorder because my colleague, Dr. Mahal Atayi, will shed light on it. What investigation we will order? Usually, acyl carnitine profile, tandem S. So very important to illustrate this concept. So a newborn screening program is done by tandem mass spectrometry. And tandem mass spectrometry machine measure acyl carnitine profile. So very important to know this concept. So we as a metabolic geneticist physician, we interchangeably mentioned these terms, which is acyl carnitine profile, tandem mass spectrometry, newborn screening. So as you know, newborn screening, some of the newborn screening tests done by not tandem mass spectrometry, it's done by genetic screening processor, like congenital adrenal hyperplasia and biotinidase deficiency. So very important to know that when you have a symptomatic patient, you need to order complete acyl carnitine profile. Newborn screening is not enough. Then plasma amino acid profile and urine organic acid, as we mentioned. And this is how we approach organic acidemia, if there is ketosis or no ketosis. I will leave this for Dr. Maha. So what is the propionic acidemia? It's due to propionyl CoA carboxylase enzyme deficiency. There is also many forms. The late onset form is heterogeneous, as we mentioned. The diagnosis by newborn screening should increase propionyl carnitine to acetyl carnitine ratio, and urine organic acid will show the high propionyl glycine, 3-hydroxypropionate, methyl citrate, tickle glycine, and lactate. The inheritance is autosomal recessive. Methyl malonic acidemia, almost the same clinical feature in the scenario. We have five responsible about methyl malonic acidemia, which is MUT gene, MAB, MHC gene, and MCE gene, which is either methyl malonyl CoA mutase deficiency, cobalamin A, cobalamin B, cobalamin D, and methyl malonyl CoA epimerase deficiency. In our country, the most common is methyl malonyl CoA mutase deficiency. However, we see also cobalamin A and cobalamin B. And I didn't see in my career methyl malonyl CoA epimerase. The clinical feature, as we mentioned, the same as propionic acidemia, methyl malonyl CoA mutase deficiency. Usually in urine organic acid, you will find the methyl malonic acid more than 1,000, while other, which is cobalamin A and cobalamin B and epimerase, you will find it less than 1,000. In mutase deficiency, you will find high 3-hydroxypropionate, 2-methyl citrate, and tigliglycine, We don't do currently complementation study or propionate incorporation assay because of advanced technology of DNA molecular testing. Acute management, similar to urea cycle, we need to have PHHND. So it's basic life support and hydration, high caloric intake, nutritional management, carnitine, and the flagyl to remove the bacterial gut metabolism, which produce methyl malonyl CoA and toxic substance. If ammonia more than 100, give carbaglu 100 to 150 milligram per kg, and then continue with 100 to 150 milligram per kg per day, Q6 hourly, and start antibiotic if indicated. Give glucose or porphyrin as tolerated. For nausea and vomiting, you may give serotonin receptor blocking agent like garanisetron. Dialysis is indicated if there is hyperammonemic coma, failure to improve after within 4 hours, ammonia more than 500 or extreme acidosis or electrolyte impact. Chronic management include diet therapy and medication, 6-day management, acute crisis management, liver transplant, and gene therapy. A very important question to ask, when you will give bicarb in case of organic acidemia, we give it only in case of refractory acidosis, because high caloric intake is your way to manage these patients. If there is a still refractory acidosis, sodium bicarb, we don't like sodium bicarb because of high sodium load will produce cerebral edema and cause hypernatremia. So in summary, urea cycle disorder is a triad of hyperammonemia, encephalopathy, alkalosis. Organic acidemia is a triad of hyperammonemia, encephalopathy, acidosis. The principle of acute management, hydration, high caloric intake, nutritional management, hyperammonemia, scavenger, dialysis, carnitine and flagyl and cofactor for organic acidemia, nutritional management triad, metabolic formula free of toxic substance, natural protein like Similac or breast milk, calories source like porphyrin or glucose. The time are crucial in management of patients with acute metabolic crisis. Biochemical geneticist and metabolic dietitian should be contacted immediately. High caloric intake is simple concept but very important in the management. And finally, expert pediatric intensive care specialist and hemodiafiltration unit should be available at management center of these cases. Please keep this life-saving medication at your pharmacy. In National Guard, we put them in a box in the ER and in a box in the BICU and in a box in NICU. And these medications include carglumic acid, aminol, sodium benzoate, sodium phenyl acetate, sodium phenyl butyrate, arginine, biotin, thiamine, vitamin B12. And we call them like the rescue box. And also this formula very important to be at your pharmacy, either from Abbott or Nutritia, any formula which is free of toxic substance. Finally, I would like to alert you about our guidelines for acute management of hyperammonemia in Middle East region. You could have more detail about clinical management of these cases and the clinical approach when you read this free PubMed article. And also, you can download my app, IEM Drug, where you could find all the metabolic medication dosages, frequency, side effect, mechanism of action, and also you could find the book manual of establishing a newborn screening program. You could find also differential diagnosis and emergency protocols. And also I encourage you to submit your articles to our journal, which is official journal of Saudi Society of Medical Genetics. Without your support and submitting article, this journal will not grow and thrive, which is one of the fairest region in genetic and metabolic field in Middle East. So with this, I will end my talk and sorry for any inconvenience and happy to answer any question. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Majid, for the very straightforward and informative lecture. And myself, I thank you very much for focusing on the nutrition part of the management of these disorders. And we really thank God that all these medications and formulas you mentioned in your lecture, we really thank God and thank the support of the Ministry of Health making these formulas are available in every almost hospitals dealing with the newborn screening program. Till now, Dr. Majid, I have one question for you. I think the people, they left all the questions till the end of the lecture. I have one question is, can oral aminol replace with IV aminol?
Can you what?
Oral aminol replaced with IV.
There is no oral aminol.
Okay.
There is sodium benzoate or sodium phenyl acetate. So okay. Aminol IV infusion.
Thank you very much, doctor.
Yes. Sodium benzoate and phenyl acetate together in one bag.
Thank you very much, Dr. Majid, and we will see you, inshallah, at the end of the webinar. And now we will switch to, you can stop your share screen so we can go to the next speaker, please, doctor, kindly. Now we will move to our next speaker, inshallah, Dr. Maha Al-Atiabi. Dr. Maha Al-Atiabi, she is our big support in the newborn screening program in the region of Riyadh. She is our coordinator in Riyadh region, and she is really help us in many answering a lot of questions for almost all the physicians around the kingdom. And she is the metabolic consultant at King Saud Medical City in Riyadh. Thank you, Dr. Maha, for accepting our invitation and share your experience with us in the newborn screening webinar. Welcome, Dr. Maha, and the mic for you. Dr. Majid, are you still with us? Dr. Majid? I think you are mute now. Yes, Dr. Majid. Yeah, until Dr. Maha will be ready, can we answer a few questions? I have more now. There is a question, what is the maximum time for medical management before start dialysis?
Well, there is the most important concept that we have, that we should start the treatment as soon as possible. And then if within 4 hours from the starting of the treatment, there is no decrease in ammonia level, then immediately start dialysis. So very important to manage these patients immediately with the basic concept, as I told you, basic life support, hydration, high caloric intake, and nutritional management, hyperammonemia scavenger. So once you receive this patient, give them high caloric intake, aminol, and according to the disease, you continue the protocol of management. And then within 4 hours of no response, and ammonia still more than 360, you should immediately start dialysis. But for us, once the patient than 360 in the ER, immediately we talk with the nephrologist and pediatric intensive care specialist to prepare if from now if the ammonia will not respond to treatment. But luckily, most of the time, ammonia responds to treatment.
Doctor, if the ammonia is high, this is my question. If the ammonia is high, but the patient is asymptomatic, There is no symptoms. He's fine. He's especially if he's old enough, يعني, like not a newborn. So is repeating the test can help with these patients? Maybe the technique of having the technique of having the blood tests can affect. Yes,
very important question. Actually, the false positive could happen with if the ammonia was not analyzed immediately, if you use tourniquet. Very important to know that ammonia should be extracted without tourniquet, put in ice, and sent immediately to the lab and analyzed within 20 minutes. So if ammonia stay more than 2 hours, for example, then it will give false positive rate.
Okay. Another question, what is the concentration for aminol in the peripheral line?
Aminol, you give the dose 250 milligram per kg, and this is how it is. You will put it in detail, and you can give it through peripheral line.
Can manage cases in ER for hyperammonemia?
Sorry?
Can cases of hyperammonemia be managed in ER? Without admission to the hospital?
It depends what is the level of hyperammonemia, but I encourage every patient who has a clear hyperammonemia to be admitted and start the management, because part of the benefit of admission is education of the patient and their family, and the family will be under your eyes. The patient under your eyes, if there's any deterioration. We saw sad stories where the patient came with mild elevation of ammonia and then discharged prematurely and came with hyperammonemic coma and end with dialysis. If this patient was admitted and managed appropriately, then you will prevent this severe crisis to happen.
Okay. Next question is,
as you mentioned, we consider the false positive result. We need really depend ourselves, our management individually based on your clinical examination and skills.
Okay. Next question, does management plans for hyperammonemia can be applied to secondary causes like liver failure or Leigh syndrome like this? The same management, or it should be different management because this is an inborn error of metabolism?
No, I mean, we could, always go for the etiology, treat the cause. This is very important.